Hello everyone, welcome. In this video, I'm going to talk about part 1 of the Constitution. Now you would know that part 1 of the Constitution deals with, it basically defines what is India and it tells the extent of Indian territory, and then it also tells some of the ways in which this territory can be appended or ceded and such features. So we'll look into the four articles under part 1 briefly here, and then one by one we are going to examine them in detail. So first of all, Article 1. Article 1 tells what is India. It says India is union of states, and further it defines its territory, that is its extent, in detail. So this extent is written in the first schedule of the Constitution. So first schedule of the Constitution owes its origin to Article 1 itself. Now, Article 2 of the Constitution, it basically gives power to the Parliament to admit or establish new states. Now, Article 2 deals with new territories of India. So, territories which were not existing, which have been added newly. Article 3, it talks about internal readjustments. So, that is, it deals with the territories which are already part of India. And Article 4, what it does, it ensures that the power of Parliament in Article 2 and 3 are easily executed. So in brief, that's the purpose of all these four articles. Now let's examine these articles one by one. So first, coming to Article 1, as I've said, Article 1 basically talks about what is India. So it defines India to be union of states. It further also gives another name to India, that is Bharat. And it is supposed to be a union of states. So union of states here stands for the federal unit of India. Now this is clause 1 of Article 1. Now coming to clause 2 of Article 1. Now it talks about Schedule 1. So the first schedule is written in Article 1, Clause 2. Now this basically gives the extent of the union and territories of India. So it includes both states and UTs. Clause 3 of Article 1, it tells upon what all comprises the term territories of India. So first of all, territories of India includes the states of India, the Union Territories of India, and any new territories which has been acquired. So that means Territories of India is a more broader term. It includes Union of India, which is the states, that is the federal unit. It includes the centrally administered regions, which are the Union Territories, and any newly acquired territory of India. Now further, one more thing I would like to add upon here, that Article 1, Clause 3, Subclause C does not exactly empower the Parliament or the Constitution to go ahead and expand. What is it ensures is that if a new territory which is rightfully ours is supposed to be added, so this addition, this assimilation of new territory is formal. Thus, Article 1, Clause 3, Subclause C ensures of assimilation of new territory in India. Now coming to Article 2. Article 2, as I've already told you, Article 2 deals with the new territories. So it gives power to the Parliament to make laws for the inclusion of these new territories in India. So what it further says is that these new territories can be added to India in two methods. So the first is admit to the existing union. That means this new territory can be added to any of the existing state of India. And the second thing it says is that this new territory can be established as a new state itself. So these are the two ways in which we can assimilate this new territory which has been added to India. So now when Portuguese finally gave us the Daman and Diu, or when the French gave us the control over Puducherry. They were added to India via Article 2. They were made a union territory at first, and then later they were turned, they were union territory, and Goa was a union territory which was later turned to state. So these all were added to India via Article 2. Now Article 3, what this does is, it basically talks about the internal readjustment of states, as I have already mentioned. So internal readjustment. Now it gives 5 ways in which this readjustment can be done. So the first one is, a new state can be created. The second one is, area of an existing state can be increased. The third is, area of the existing state can be decreased. Fourth is, some alteration in the boundary. And the fifth is, change of name. So these are the 5 internal readjustment or alteration that the Constitution talks about with respect to Article 3. It further goes on to say that any bill which is to be introduced for this purpose shall only be introduced upon the recommendation of the President of India. So the President recommends that to the Parliament that the boundary of a state can be changed, its area can be increased or decreased. Now this bill that is introduced in Parliament cannot be passed before the state where this rearrangement needs to be done, its opinion has been taken. So Constitution allows for taking the opinion of the state where some alteration is to be done. So now, however, this opinion is not binding. Do note that. So this opinion that the Parliament takes from the state, it is not binding by nature. Now the next question that arises here, why the power has been given to the Parliament to do such a thing? Why Parliament gets to change the state's boundary without, even if the state doesn't agree to this, still it can change? Why it has been done? Especially now, if we compare to the federal system of United States, that cannot be done. United States is a indestructible union of indestructible states, but India is an indestructible union of destructible states. So the question, why power given to the Parliament to do such a thing? This question was also raised in the Constituent Assembly debates. Now the opinion there given was, what if the minority in a state wants a new state while the majority does not? So then the demand of this minority will never be fulfilled, even if it is justified. And for that reason, the Constituent Assembly gave this power to the Parliament to rearrange the state's boundaries without being bound by the opinion of the states. Now, when President sends this, when President asks this question to the states, if they, what is their opinion on this matter, the President gives a certain time frame to the states. Now, within that time frame, state can say yes, it can say no, or it can do nothing on it. It doesn't matter to the Parliament. Parliament, if it wants, can go ahead with the proposal that it has already put in the House. Now, further, say the opinion of the Parliament of the state has been taken, and then Parliament then amends that bill. So, state has given opinion on a certain bill, but Parliament, after taking that opinion, feels that there is an amendment needed, then the Parliament doesn't need to ask the opinion of the state again for that amendment which is done. So this happened in case of the state of Bombay, which was divided into later Maharashtra and Gujarat. However, earlier the proposal when it was sent, there was a UT of Bombay to be created as well. But later, after seeking the opinion of the state, which gave a go-ahead, Parliament changed this, and UT of the plan to create a UT of Bombay was dropped, and only Maharashtra and Gujarat were carved out of the state of Bombay. So thus, if the opinion has already been tendered, Parliament can still amend that bill. Now, another thing that came to light in the case you would have heard called Berubari Union. In the Berubari Union case, what happened was the Supreme Court opined that this new territory which is added to India, it can be assimilated in the territory of India either via Article 2 or via Article 3. So there are two provisions in Article 3. The first one talks about creation of new state, and the second one talks about increasing the area of a state. So both this provision can also be used to assimilate this new territory. So there was this place called Chandernagar in West Bengal, which was like we got from East Pakistan or the new Bangladesh, which was assimilated to India via Article 3. So thus, a new territory can be assimilated via both Article 2 and Article 3 of the Constitution. Now further, earlier until 1966, until 1966, the Article 3 only dealt with creation or modification in state and not the UTs. So this was until 1966. After 1966, 18th Constitutional Amendment was passed. And by virtue of 18th Constitutional Amendment, what it did was it added an explanation to Article 3 which said that state here would also read UTs. So ever since 18th Amendment, Article 3 can be used to create or readjust boundaries of Union territories as well. So this is with respect to Article 3. This specific thing that I have discussed here, we'll talk about it again in when discussing Article 4. Now Article 4, it relates directly to Article 2 and 3 of the Constitution. What it does is Article 4 ensures that any amendment, any law of Parliament which gives effect to its power under Article 2 and 3 need not require an amendment of the Constitution under Article 368. Like I have already told you, first schedule of the Constitution defines the territories of India. So it divides this territory into Union plus UTs as well. So Union, by Union here I mean states and UTs as well. So now whenever a new state is created or UT is created, there needs to be changes done in first schedule. Now every time you want to create a state, you will need to amend the Constitution to amend first schedule. But by virtue of Article 4, you need not. Any act of Parliament to give effect to Article 2 and 3 can amend first schedule without passing a Constitutional Amendment Act. So a simple act of Parliament can change this first schedule. Similarly, it can change the fourth schedule. Now, fourth schedule deals with the seats of states in the Rajya Sabha. So, Parliament, an act of Parliament can change fourth schedule as well without any Constitutional Amendment Act. And further, any consequential matter can also be amended. So now when the state of Telangana was created, Article 168 and Article 371D were also amended via the Act of Parliament. So there was no separate Constitutional Amendment Act needed to create Telangana, where these articles were also amended. So, and Parliament can also amend other matters like where seats in state legislature is concerned, or seats in Parliament with respect to Lok Sabha and etc. is concerned can also be amended without actually passing an amendment act. Now here we can ask a question, why again? Why such ease has been given with respect to 2 and 3? So what happened was, when constitution was made, we were pressed for time because we wanted to have a constitution, an active constitution, as soon as possible. So if we wanted to divide these states, which were already divided by various acts passed by the British Parliament, so historical as well as political division, at the time of writing the constitution, it would have taken a bit longer to execute our constitution. So hence the Parliament figured that we can go ahead with the present arrangement, that is the arrangement which exists pre-independence, and then later we can change these boundaries as we deem fit. Parliament also thought that the state's boundary should basically be based on three criteria. So either it should be social, cultural or linguistic uniformity. So to ensure that whenever we actually rearrange the state boundaries based on any of these three criteria, it is not an arduous task, and hence Article 4 was inserted. Now later, as you know, in 1956, we did rearrange state's boundary based on linguistic criteria as the Fazal Ali Commission suggested. So, by virtue of Article 4, Article 2 and 3 can be amended by simply law of Parliament. Now here, do remember, like I said in Article 3, UTs were not included before 1966. So they were not included in Article 3. Therefore, when UTs of Daman or Diu or Goa or Pondicherry, Puducherry, the new name, they were added to India, they were added via constitutional amendment. However, after 1966, after the 18th Constitutional Amendment Act was passed, the new UTs that were added to India, they were simply added by an Act of Parliament. So, for example, UT of Jammu and Kashmir, which was added in 2019, was added by an Act of Parliament. Again, in 1966 itself, Chandigarh was added as a new UT. This was again done by an Act of Parliament. Thus, after the 18th Constitutional Amendment Act, Article 3, by virtue of Article 3, even the UTs can be amended. I mean, UTs can be modified, created, or destroyed for that matter, simply by an Act of Parliament. So this is the significance of Article 4. Now for mains examination, do remember two things. With respect to Article 3, why the power was given to Parliament, and with respect to Article 4, why there was such ease to amend, like with respect to Article 2 and 3. Now we'll come and look at some of the landmark cases. So now I have already mentioned about the Berubari Union case once. Now you would have read about this case with respect to preamble. But what exactly is this case relates to is part 1 of the constitution itself. Now what happened was, Berubari was a small area in West Bengal. Now the central government decided to cede it to East Pakistan, that is the modern Bangladesh. Now central government figured they can do it under Article 3 subclause C, which basically talks about diminishing the area of a state. So but Parliament figured that Article 3 subclause C gives them the power to diminish the area of the state. 3(1)(c) I think. Anyway, so it gives them power to diminish the area of the state, but this is not so as decided by the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court said that Article 3 does not give power of secession. What Article 3 gives is power to reduce internal rearrangement, not external rearrangement. The ceding of territory to a sovereign nation requires a constitutional amendment because it amends Article 1 of the Constitution. That is, it amends the territorial extent of India. And hence, it requires a constitutional amendment because Article 4 does not empower Parliament to pass acts related to Article 1 without introducing a constitutional amendment. So, this is the significance of the Berubari Union case. I have already discussed that Berubari Union case also said that a new territory can be incorporated in India both via Article 2 and via Article 3. Now, coming to the next case, that is Pudyal versus Union of India. Now, this case relates to the assimilation of state of Sikkim to India. Now, if you remember the history of Sikkim, Sikkim was a protectorate of India after independence. It was under the rule of Chogyal rulers. It had its own congress, that is its own parliament. Three subjects were given to India, that is external affairs, communication and defense. Now, in 1974, the Congress of Sikkim passed a resolution which allowed for greater integration with India. And the Chogyal rulers assented to this resolution, and hence Indian government passed the 35th Constitutional Amendment Act, where Article 2A was inserted and 10th schedule was inserted. So Article 2A, what it said was, Sikkim was created as an associated state of India. Later, the Chogyal rulers internationalized this issue as they wanted to go back to this arrangement. Obviously, they felt like they have lost their power and everyone likes power. But the Congress of Sikkim was very dissatisfied with this move and they finally passed a resolution for full integration with India. And consequently, the Indian government passed the 36th Constitutional Amendment Act, under which 2A was omitted, 10th schedule was omitted, and Sikkim was given full statehood of India. So this issue was challenged in court. Now, Supreme Court didn't find any problem with this, but it did come to the conclusion that Article 2, the power given to Parliament under Article 2, is not unlimited and it is subject to judicial review. That means that whenever an act is made by Parliament under Article 2, it should conform to the Constitution of India. It should conform to the scheme of the Constitution as well as the features of the Constitution. Thus, basically, that means Article 2 is not immune to judicial review. So, this is with respect to the two major cases related to Part 1 of the Constitution. Now, we will look at when some of the states of India were created. So, this is I know it is something you have to remember, but please try to remember as far as you can, because UPSC has asked questions related to this in the past. Now, first let's look at the states. So, Maharashtra and Gujarat were added in 1960. I have already discussed something about this, where the opinion was taken and then the bill was amended. So, the state of Bombay was divided into Maharashtra and Gujarat in 1960. Oh, one more thing, we are talking about all this thing after 1956, that is the reorganization in 1956. A state of Nagaland was created in 1963. State of Punjab was divided into Haryana and modern Punjab in 1966 again. And the hilly areas were given to Himachal Pradesh, which was still a UT as per 1956 Reorganization Act. But in 1971, Himachal Pradesh got full statehood. Now then another three states were made, Manipur, Meghalaya and Tripura. Manipur and Tripura were UTs, and Meghalaya was a sub-state under Assam. No need to know, just remember when it was added. So 1972. We have already discussed the story of Sikkim, which was added, which was given full statehood in 1975 and associate statehood in 1974. Then Mizoram, Arunachal and Goa, they were given statehood. So as I said, Goa was first UT and then later given statehood. So this was done in 1987. Further, coming to more recent ones, Chhattisgarh, Uttarakhand and Jharkhand were given statehood in 2000. And the most recent one, that is Telangana, was given a statehood in 2004. So Telangana was made a state in 2004. This is the latest addition to the states of India. Now coming to UTs, Dadar and Nagar Haveli by Portuguese and Goa and Daman and Diu also given to India by Portuguese in 1961 and 62. These were added, actually all these three were added to India by a constitutional amendment, as we have discussed, because the 18th Constitutional Amendment Act was not passed yet, and thus Article 3 read together with Article 4 could not have been used to just assimilate these via an Act of Parliament. Chandigarh, however, was added by an Act of Parliament because by then the 18th Constitutional Amendment Act was passed. Now coming to the latest changes, Jammu and Kashmir was stripped of its statehood in 2019 and it was divided into two UTs, UTs of J&K and UT of Leh. J&K has legislative assembly, Leh does not. And finally, the most recent one, Dadar and Nagar Haveli and Daman and Diu have been merged as one UT in 2020. So I think the date of execution is 26th of Jan 2020. Please check it out. So this is it for the formation of new states and UTs in India. So we have covered Article 1 to 4. We have seen two of the major cases, Berubari Union and Podiyal case. And we have also looked at the dates of creation of some of the UTs and states in India. Now let's look at some past year question that has been asked in the exam. So the first one here is, if a new state of the Union India is to be created, which one of the following schedules of the Constitution must be amended? So I've already discussed this. Article 4 explicitly talks about the first and the fourth schedule. Now, first deals with the territorial extent and fourth deals with representation in Rajya Sabha. In the option, we don't see fourth schedule. So the answer is A, first. Now, as a homework, I would like you to go through the second, third, fifth, actually go through all the schedules, because question may come, like a match the following question may come or anything. So just go through what all the schedules deal with. There are 12 schedules. Now the next question is, which one of the following is the correct chronological order for the formation of the following as full state of Indian Union? So full state. Now let's look at these four states that we are talking about here. Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland and Haryana. So Sikkim, I've told you in detail the story of Sikkim added in 1975. Arunachal Pradesh, you might not remember. It's 1987. Try to remember, otherwise let's see. Nagaland, 1963. Try to remember, as this was the second state that was formed after the, like, second group of state which was formed after the State Reorganization Act in 1956. And then Haryana finally in 1966. Now Sikkim in 1975 and Nagaland in 1963. So if you remember Nagaland 1963, you can safely assume, and if you know Sikkim, you can safely assume that the answer should be either B or E. Now, if you remember, if you have even slightest of idea with respect to the reorganization of Punjab, especially with respect to also because the UT of Chandigarh was created. If you remember any of these, and UT of Chandigarh was created by an act, so like something to remember, something specific about it to remember. If you remember that, you can safely arrive at the answer that Haryana was done before Sikkim, and hence option B should be right. Otherwise, if you remember all the dates, that's even great. You can very easily say Nagaland, Haryana, Sikkim and Arunachal Pradesh. Now, that is why I have asked you to remember the dates, because it is very difficult to do chronological order questions. UPSC asks confusing question in this. It has done even recently, as like in 2018 as well. They asked some events that were completely unrelated and it asked their chronological order. So I would recommend, if at all possible, please remember. Now, way to remember is, have a list, like you can use the list that I have written in this slide only. Get it printed or just set it as the wallpaper of your desktop. Look at it for 2 to 3 minutes daily, and within 10 days, I can guarantee you that you will remember each of these, like when each of these states were created. So now the final question, this hasn't been asked in the exam. So this is a practice question for you. The statement reads, consider the following. The expression Union of India includes only the federal units, that is the states. This is true. I have already told you in when we are discussing Article 1. The expression Territories of India includes only the UTs. Now this is wrong. I have told Territories of India includes the states, the UTs, as well as any new territory which can be occupied. Thus, statement 2 is incorrect, 1 is right. So the answer is A, 1 only. Now, I hope this topic is clear to you. Now, it is not very important, but as I have said recently, in 2019, since the UT of Jammu and Kashmir was created after changing the state, like taking away the statehood, and then merger of two UTs, that is with respect to Dadar and Nagar Haveli and Daman and Diu. So it may be somewhat important for the coming prelims examination as well as mains. So go through this, and if you have any doubt, let me know. Thank you. Have a good day.